Hey guys, welcome back to the Dr. Cliff AUD vlog. This is vlog number 173, and today I am joined with my wife, Ashley, because we're gonna be talking about our Australia trip, and we'll start off a little bit by talking about the actual conference and what your experience was during the conference, and then we'll go into some more of the fun stuff that we got to do while we were out of the country. So, Ashley, thank you for joining us today.
Yeah, it's nice to be back. It's been a while.
It has been a long while, actually.
Yeah, patients have been coming in, and they're like, oh, we haven't seen you on the vlog lately, and I'm like, oh, boy.
Yeah, well, here you are.
I guess I better prepare myself.
There you go. And I think that I was basically asking you if you wanted to be on this. You're like, yeah, sure, we'll share the story of Australia. So obviously we went, it's about a month ago now that we actually went out to Australia. We started off with a little bit of jet lag, then we got into the conference. But what was your experience while we were at the conference starting out?
I think it was a really great conference that they put on. I actually didn't go to the AAA conference in the States this year. So it was kind of nice to be able to meet new fellow colleagues in the industry in Australia. That was kind of fun. I did think all the speakers that I listened to were really great. And it was just neat to meet new audiologists that had a different perspective on the industry in their particular country and learn what's similar, but also what's different.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, we had, like I said, a little bit of jet lag starting off, but it was about a four-day conference. You were an active participant there about three of the 4 days. Mm-hmm. And we kicked off with my keynote talk. So what was your perception of how that talk went?
I thought it went really well. I wasn't really quite sure how it was going to go because sometimes the culture in different countries is different and they have different words with different meanings, but overall I thought the keynote went really well. But I mean, I always think that Cliff does a really good job at speaking. It's kind of a natural talent that he just happens to have. He's one of those lucky ones. I always think you do a good job. I know that I'm biased because you're my husband, but after the talk, everyone usually will come up to you, but I get a lot of people that come up to me and just are like raving fans and are very appreciative that we take the time to travel all the way over there and that they got a lot out of your talk.
Yeah, for sure. And then what was your perception? Because we also had the mastermind that we did about creating content. What was your feel with that?
I think that was really an eye-opening experience for a lot of audiologists because it helps them to understand how they can be a bit more creative in the content that they are creating and maybe how to approach it. Because sometimes it's just like this, well, I don't know what to do. So you just kind of stay there in that spot and it's like 5 years later, you haven't done anything. So it was nice that you kind of helped them like take baby steps on like, here's the first five things that you can do and let's test it out and do an experiment here while we're in this class. So that, I mean, everyone really loved that.
I was trying to make content creation more approachable and like give them an idea of where to start because it does take so much time and effort going into it.
Yeah, and I think like it's not realistic to have a talk like that and expect individuals to take every weekend for the next year to do content. So let's make it realistic and how they can start baby steps to creating some organic content for their practice.
For sure, for sure. And so then we had also had the panel discussion, me and three other individuals. What was your perception of that talk?
Well, I think a lot of the questions that were geared towards you were about like content creation, maybe over-the-counter type stuff. I feel like you get a lot of questions that are kind of outside the box because you're comfortable thinking outside of the box. A lot of scientific discussion during that panel discussion. Some stuff was a bit over my head, but
there was a little bit of discussion amongst hearing aid manufacturers that were there that were not necessarily happy with the way that I was talking about our industry as a whole and what I believe to be the most important thing when it comes to hearing treatment.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, I think that that's probably also why individuals like you, because you're going to be honest and you're honest in a way that's respectful, but you're not going to say things that you don't feel are what you believe in or what's not truth. But you do it in a tactful way. And also, I think it's good that you say those things because like the manufacturers, they need to hear this too, because when they're out there making products and doing the scientific research for their equipment, they need to understand like really who they're advocating for the patient.
Yeah, you know, I, my biggest thing when I was there is that, you know, everyone talks about these newest, latest, and greatest hearing aids, and my stance is like, all that stuff's great, we need it, but that is not what matters really when it comes down to achieving high-level outcomes from a treatment perspective. And the other thing about Australia is that they're so vertically integrated where the manufacturers are like owning a ton of clinics. Yeah. The government has a heavy hand in what goes on in that particular country, and so yeah. there's things that I'm like, I don't know if you guys are gonna like the way things head here in the future if this continues to be the case in the country of Australia.
Yeah, and I think it's good that it's good that we're talking about it, because I think consumers in Australia need to really understand like what they're up against or what they're in the amongst when it comes to hearing treatment. Like, a lot of consumers probably have no idea that's what's happening and why that maybe isn't the best way for them to have audiologic care provided to them.
Right. You know, and there's definitely some positives about how things are done in Australia versus the United States, but a lot of my keynote was basically this cautionary tale of the direction that things headed here in the United States, and eventually that's going to work its way to Australia, and those are not positive things that I'm talking about in those particular talks. And then the last talk that we gave was the Hearing Up Network talk. Mm-hmm. How do you feel like that one went amongst the Australian providers?
They had a lot of interest, a lot of questions. I think maybe because of the way things are in Australia, maybe they just weren't sure how Hearing Up would integrate into the system with how the vertical integration was and how involved the government was. But I spoke to a lot of private practice audiologists at the conference, and they have a lot of patients that are, you know, non-government participating. I don't know if that's the right term.
Yeah, they have like a pension system there.
Yeah.
And a lot of their residents are a part of the pension program, and the pension program will provide them with like basic level hearing aids, and then they do require that real ear measurement is done. But there's a lot of best practices that are not mandated by the government. And the funny thing was is that when we went there, they're like, oh yeah, we follow best practices. And I started talking to them like, you follow some best practices, but you don't follow comprehensive best practices.
Yeah.
And that is not good for the patient at the end of the day. So we definitely see a strong need for the Hearing Up Network in Australia to help shine a light on the really good providers who are following comprehensive best practices. So, but that was pretty much it for the conference. I stayed for an additional day, not where I talked at all, but because I'm just so interested in audiology, I wanted to hear more of the research and all of that they have going on there in Australia. We got an opportunity to go over to the National Acoustics Laboratory.
Yes.
And they were presenting a lot of their research at the conference, so that was really exciting. But let's get away from the work-related stuff here.
Okay.
So we were in the Gold Coast, which is actually, what, is that a city? I don't know what they call it.
Well, I think it's like an area.
Yeah.
I feel like there's different cities within Gold Coast. I think Gold Coast is just like an area, kind of like Sunshine Coast, maybe. I could be wrong on this, but.
Yeah. Well, nonetheless, we were in the Gold Coast, and it was beautiful there.
Yeah.
And we stuck around there for a couple days after, and we went to, what was it, the Kurumbin Animal Sanctuary?
Yes.
Yeah, so what was your favorite part about that?
I feel like most people probably love the koalas, because they're really cute.
We actually held a koala bear.
We did get to hold them. We actually purchased a separate ticket to be able to go inside the area where they keep the koalas. And I really like that, because I got to do one-on-one with the, I don't know what their technical term is, like one of the keepers, and ask questions. The whole center really is intended to educate the locals and tourists like ourselves about the native animals and which ones are endangered, why are they endangered, what can the communities surrounding do to help preserve those animals, which I think is really important, because we need all of the various animals for the cycle of nature.
And pretty much all the animals there were rescued animals that were injured or something like that.
Yeah, they
wouldn't be able to survive out in the wilderness on their own anymore.
Yeah, I know that they have an animal hospital there, and you could actually kind of walk up and look inside, see where they do surgeries and stuff. So they will take in animals that are injured, and if they can, once they're healed, release them back. I think there's probably not all of them can, and maybe some that can't stay there.
Yeah.
But I know that the koalas in particular, they're having a really big problem with, because along the coast, they're tearing down a lot of the eucalyptus. They're building up these big buildings. Humans are taking over. They're getting hit by cars. So it's just kind of sad, but hopefully the local communities can come together and help save the koalas.
Yeah. And then after that, we actually, so we spent, another couple days in Gold Coast, and then we went down to Byron Bay.
Yep.
What was your favorite part about Byron Bay?
Well, I was really excited about just kind of walking in the little seaside town. It kind of has that small, quaint feel, although it was quite touristy. There's a lot of people there.
But not as many as usual, because the time of year is kind of changing.
It was the, like, off season. It was encroaching into their winter time, so I think it was a bit cooler. And it was pretty cool, especially along the ocean there. A lot of breeze, and it could rain, so I always wore like a long sleeve shirt. But the walking along the seaside town of Byron Bay I really enjoyed. And then I thought the lighthouse was really, really pretty. Just really gorgeous views up there. So if you get a chance to go to the Gold Coast, go to Byron Bay. But I would stay at Airbnb near the town, so you can just walk the downtown.
Yeah, because it was a ways away where we stayed. We had to get an Uber if we wanted to go into town to eat. I was able to run from our resort up to the lighthouse, which was really cool, but that was about five miles out, 5 miles back.
The other really cool thing, I mean, the resort was very nice. It would have been funner had it been a little bit warm and sunny.
Yeah.
We had our own beach access there, which was really cool. I really, really liked having the private beach. That's kind of like if you did an Airbnb, you wouldn't have had the private beach. You would have had to go to the public, and it's more busy. So I guess if you're going to go, maybe stay a couple of days at the resort, a couple of days downtown Byron Bay. I don't know.
They also had a triathlon there in town while we were there, which is kind of fun.
And had we known, you could have been in it.
Yeah, I could have been in it.
You
didn't have
a bike.
I could have rented a bike,
rented
I guess.
A bike.
Yeah, yeah. That was good. But we only stayed really 2 days there. Then we went down to Sydney for like 4 or 5 days.
Right? Yes. Yeah. And that was really fun. I felt like Sydney kind of reminded me a little bit of Europe. Really pretty historic buildings. Went to the Museum of Sydney to learn more about how Sydney became a city and its growth and history.
That was cool.
That was really fun. We went and saw the Opera House, which was, it's huge.
Yeah.
It doesn't look quite as big in pictures, and you don't realize how big it is until you're walking around it. We walked through the Botanical Gardens, which were gorgeous. Ran into some really loud birds.
Oh yeah, those birds, man. They're on a different
larrikeets?
Level. If you're wearing like...
They're larrikeets.
Yeah, well if
they're white ones. In America, we love them. We're like, oh, they can learn how to talk. But when they're out in the wild,
if you
out.
Think the birds here in the United States are loud when
they're
you first
so
get
loud.
Your hearing aids, it's on a different
it.
Level
And they were
out
all
there.
Flocking to like two trees in there. So I don't know
what
that was all about, but that was just interesting.
So we ended up taking a trip from, like a guided trip from Sydney out to the Blue Mountains as well.
Yeah, we went to the Blue Mountains, and I, like when I go on vacations, I usually want to go to a place where there's mountains because I really like hiking and trail running and stuff. So the Blue Mountains, were quite a bit smaller than what we're used to, even in like Flagstaff, certainly a little bit smaller than they were in Colorado. But nonetheless, they're really pretty. More like rainforesty. They had like a lot of palms and eucalyptus on the mountains. And it isn't like the mountains came to a peak. It was almost like they
like
kind
plateaus,
of like a plateau. Is that called a bluff?
I don't know.
And then had a lot of rock edges with like waterfalls. So that was really pretty.
We waterfalls had about an hour hike along the edge of the cliff face, which was cool.
And the interesting thing that I remember is like we didn't see any animals. I didn't see a lizard. We saw a few like little birds.
Yeah, yeah.
But there weren't like chipmunks or squirrels, nothing like that.
Yeah.
So that was a little bit different than usually what we see in America.
So what's cool is that the reason they call them the Blue Mountains is because what the humidity in the air mixes with the eucalyptus oils in the tree, and it creates this like blue hue when you look out across the valley in the mountains, which is really cool.
It was really pretty. The mountain towns there were different than how the mountain towns are that I've experienced in America, but still really quaint. I would have loved to stop in some of the smaller, older communities in the mountains.
Just didn't have time because it was a day trip out there.
It was a day trip.
But you also got to see like a rare pine tree out there as well.
Oh yeah, shoot, what was it called?
I don't remember, but I'll put up a photo of it here in the vlog.
So, okay, apparently what happened is this I don't know the scientific terms of all of these individuals, but an individual who goes out into the wild and studies plants, he was doing that and discovered this new...
Did I say palm tree?
It's not a palm tree.
It's like an evergreen.
It's like a rainforest version
like
of a
pine tree.
Pine tree.
Yeah.
But this gentleman found it, went back to the lab, and basically they found this rare area, like this one area in the Blue Mountains where these trees
super rare trees
live. And they won't tell you where they're at in the Blue Mountains because they don't want anyone going and...
like chopping them down or harming them.
But they had one at the
Botanical Gardens,
in the Blue Mountains. And so that was the one thing I for sure wanted to go. So we wouldn't have learned about that had we not gone to the Education Center first.
Right.
Which you wanted us to go, and I was like, no, let's go walking. He's like, we got to go learn.
Yeah.
So we went and learned about this stuff, and then that's when I was like, oh my gosh, this is like a rare species of tree, and it's here in this garden. We got to go look at it. So we did, and I was so excited, and we took a picture of it.
That was fun. So, that pretty much rounded it out. We ended up going, we ate out pretty much every night that we were there, which is not our style. But
it's not really my jam, but...
yeah, it worked out. It worked out well. I was very grateful to be able to go. I think that staying for a 16-day trip out of the country is a really long time period.
It was long.
Our next trip is going to be, an 11-day or 10 or
11-day? It's 10 days in South Africa, and it'll be, I think, just enough time for us to experience a couple different fun things and be able to come back and not be quite as burnt out from vacationing. Not to sound... ungrateful or anything, but it's just a long time.
Yeah, and I just don't like being away from work that long. It took me a ton of time to prep enough videos to be gone that long.
It's a long time.
Yeah.
Plus our dog was home. And
that's true. But Charlie was good when we got back, our dog Charlie.
Oh my gosh, I think she preferred having the babysitters.
Yeah, we had a ton of help with Ashley's mom and Bree.
Yep, she loves Bree.
Yeah, so that's good. But no, it was a good trip. What was your favorite part to finish off here? Favorite part of the whole trip?
Honestly, even though I love Sydney, well, I really liked visiting Nau and Cochlear. Those were really cool.
And we did that while we were in Sydney. We took a day to go and talk at Nau and visit Cochlear.
I just thought that was just the coolest thing, to see how cochlear implant was made and all the different things. But anyway, I would say I liked the Gold Coast because it was warm and sunny, but had a nice breeze, and it was more slow paced. And I don't know, but I'm not a huge beach person, but it just seemed very relaxing.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I like the Gold Coast myself because they had a really nice boardwalk along the entire beach, and I could run as far as I wanted to on that boardwalk.
I don't know how many miles that was.
Yeah.
But.
Yeah. Because it was connecting all those towns along the coast there, which was cool. But enjoyed that a lot myself. So, but nonetheless, got that knocked out. Got another one coming up here in a couple of months that I have to start preparing my talks for, which I should probably go right now and start working on that. But hey, guys, thank you for joining us. Ashley, thank you for joining me on the vlog again.
Thanks for having
me. We'll have to have you back on again in 2024.
Okay.
I think we do once a year, we bring you on the vlog.
Yeah.
But nonetheless, guys, thank you so much. If you like the video, go ahead and give it a thumbs up. If you're not yet subscribed, go ahead and hit that subscribe button with notification bell. And as always, we will see you next week.